Mr. Nigel, due governi di due stati democratici si sono dimessi a distanza di un giorno l'uno dall'altro e sono stati rimpiazzati da due governi tecnici guidati da uomini provenienti dagli uffici internazionali dell'alta finanza e della commissione trilaterale, Mario Monti e Lucas Papademos. Si tratta di una coincidenza?
There are all sorts of conspiracy theories swirling around as to why the events in Greece and Italy happened as they did. We can never be certain. What we do know is that two democratically elected premiers were removed by the bully boys from Brussels. They weren't acceptable anymore. Of course, in the case of Greece, Mr. Papandreou dared to swear in public. Yes, he used the word R, the referendum word. Unacceptable. He had to go. Mr. Berlusconi was beyond the pale. And things in Greece may look to be bad, but in Italy, we've got Mr. Monti, a former European commissioner, one of the architects of the Eurozone disaster, unelected, not even a member of the parliament at the time this idea came through. And then to compound it all, he's chosen a cabinet of people, not one of whom is a democratically elected politician. Whatever the source of all of this is, I think we have to say, if we believe in freedom and democracy, it is a monstrosity. Is this all a coincidence? No. It's all about control.
Nonostante uno stato di crisi di gravità comparabile, a differenza dell'Italia, la Spagna è andata incontro a regolari elezioni. Quali sono le differenze reali fra i due approcci?
Well, of course, on Sunday the Spanish had an election, and it was very interesting. I was on British television live as the results came through, and I did say, why did they bother? I mean, you know, why have an election? Because after all, effectively, their hands are tied. And we saw today in the press that the first thing Mr. Rajoy has done is to go to Angela Merkel to get his instructions. And of course, if a few months down the road they're not happy with him, he'll be sacked and replaced by somebody else. What is really happening as a result of this Eurozone crisis is that democracy is actually deliberately and willfully being destroyed by people who will do anything to prop up their failed and failing Euro dream.
Cosa pensa della soddisfazione di una parte del popolo italiano per la sostituzione del governo Berlusconi con un governo tecnico? Vi è un sentimento diffuso tra la popolazione di rassegnazione all'incapacità di esprimere una buona classe dirigente dal basso, per cui molti preferiscono una soluzione imposta dall'alto.
Okay, so there's an argument that Mr. Berlusconi wasn't a very good premier. That may or may not be true, but the essence of parliamentary democracy is however bad your government is, you, the people, get a chance, an opportunity in general elections to remove them and replace them with somebody else. The argument that he wasn't up to it, the argument that a technocratic government of experts will somehow be better, I think is wrong on two counts. Firstly, that Mr. Monti is one of the architects of this failure in the first place. And secondly, this is how dictatorship begins. A state of emergency is declared. Normal laws of democracy, normal judicial laws are suspended, and someone takes charge for the good of the country. This is how dictatorship begins. It is not justified, in my view, in any circumstances at all.
Uno degli obiettivi di Mario Monti nella commissione trilaterale era di perseguire con dedizione la totale unificazione europea. Crede che, come Presidente del Consiglio, oggi stia facendo gli interessi del popolo italiano o quelli delle organizzazioni internazionali nelle quali ha ricoperto ruoli apicali?
What's for certain is that Mr. Monti has no popular mandate of any kind at all. What is also for certain is that he wants to make sure that Greece, and of course Italy as well, stay part of the Euro and stay part of the European project. I can't for the life of me understand why ordinary, decent Italian people are prepared to put up with this. It is an absolute monstrosity that has been put upon them. And we've seen in Athens people taking to the streets. And I tell you what, if I was in Italy, I'd be tempted to do the very same thing.
Cosa ne pensa del MES? Il trattato europeo in corso di approvazione che darà a 17 governatori, tra cui Mario Monti, il potere di esigere qualunque somma dagli stati membri e di contro li renderà immuni da qualunque procedimento giudiziario, oltre a dichiarare segreti ed inviolabili tutti i loro archivi ed i loro documenti.
So with the euro crisis, the answer, of course, is more Europe. That's what we hear from Mr. Barroso and Mr. Van Rompuy. And now we have this new ESM treaty, the European Stabilisation Mechanism. And the idea is there'll be a treaty change coming up, perhaps within the next 18 months or 2 years, that will make the bailouts that we've had already of Eurozone states something that is actually legal, which to date, of course, it has not been. This new treaty is, I think, the worst development yet in the European Union. It gives complete arbitrary power to unelected foreign bureaucrats to take control of the economies of countries. And even if they make an absolute mess of the whole thing, it gives them a total immunity from prosecution for life. This ESM treaty change is something that should and needs to be put to a referendum in every member state, and the Italians should not take this lying down. Surely you've got to decide your own future at some point. You can't rely on Mr. Monti and others doing what is in your best interest.
Perché ha accusato Mr. Rompuy di non avere nessuna legittimazione democratica? Perché lo considera responsabile di quanto sta accadendo al popolo italiano?
Well, my old friend Herman Van Rompuy, now 18 months ago he and I clashed a bit in the European Parliament, and I did give an alternative curriculum vitae of his background. But where I was right, convinced I was right, is in saying that he had no democratic legitimacy. Listen, he hasn't been voted for by anybody. There is no mechanism for ordinary voters in any European country to remove him. And I thought the most remarkable thing about this recent Italian debacle was the sight of this unelected man from Brussels being in Florence and saying to the Italian people, this is not the time for elections, this is the time for action. Who in God's name gave him the right to say that to the Italian people?
Cosa ne pensa delle affermazioni di Sarkozy e della Merkel, secondo cui chi fa cadere l'euro si renderà responsabile dell'accensione di una nuova stagione di conflitti militari tra i paesi europei?
Well, I met Angela Merkel a month ago. And I asked her a question. I said, why can't Greece be allowed to get free, to get her own currency back, to have a devaluation, to have proper democratic government? Merkel's answer was clear. If Greece is allowed to go, other countries will follow too. So the argument here is that the European project must be propped up. You know, whatever the cost, in economic terms or in democratic terms, this must hold together. And then when they really get desperate, they say, if the euro fell, there'd be a war. What war? Who is going to invade who? Are we assuming that the Germans would rearm and invade France? I don't think so. These are the old scare tactics that are being used. And we should remember that actually wars can be caused by people artificially being forced together against their will. Remember, it happened in the Balkans, it happened in the last century, we saw the full ramifications of it in the last 20 years, and it was called Yugoslavia. There is more likelihood of civil unrest, unpleasantness, and possibly even civil war if we go on imposing upon the peoples of Europe a form of government they haven't chosen and don't want.
Lei è contro l'Unione Europea. Come pensa che i singoli stati possano sopravvivere in un'era di mercati globali, se lasciati da soli a confrontarsi con le potenze emergenti, senza un'unione forte?
The globalization argument is a very big one. And one of the analogies is that here we are, think of the Atlantic in a huge storm, and there are massive waves breaking everywhere, and it's incredibly dangerous. And the argument is that if we're all together on one big ship, that somehow we'll be safer and we can face those violent storms in a way with a greater hope, a greater expectation of survival. I would argue that actually the most important thing to survive an Atlantic storm is not to be on a great big ship, which could possibly be called the Titanic, I suppose. The most important thing when going through choppy waters is to have your hand on the tiller and to be able to steer the right course and to steer the right direction. In terms of trade, in terms of international relationships, in terms of foreign policy, my country, the UK and Italy, have completely different approaches. It doesn't mean I'm better than you, doesn't mean I'm worse than you, but it does mean that my country is very different to yours. And I would argue we've got a better, bigger chance of surviving those huge storms that cross the world's oceans if we actually are able to steer our own course through them, rather than that decision being made on behalf of 27 different people with conflicting different ideas, and the whole thing being a fudge and a compromise that doesn't suit anybody, and headed up by unelected bureaucrats in the European Commission, who we've seen in every other policy area have failed us over the last couple of decades.
Non crede che vi sia un'eccessiva dominazione dei mercati. Invece di perseguire un modello di società incentrato sul benessere dei cittadini, ritiene giusto che le regole del mercato e della speculazione debbano prevalere, al punto da mettere in crisi intere popolazioni, sebbene in fondo esse abbiano tutte le risorse fisiche necessarie per vivere bene?
So the old argument is that the state can sort people's lives out best. The state can make sure that from cradle to grave you're looked after and you're prosperous and you have jobs. Well, the record of this isn't actually terribly good. Look at the Soviet Union. They thought that in the early days, and look at the absolute disaster that they created. I know that the free market society has excesses. It has people that are prepared to break the law, to break rules, that the profit motive can become the greed motive. But I'll tell you this, my total understanding of the way that human society has evolved is that if you want to have schools and hospitals and social health care and all of those things, you have to create profit, because it's from profit that people pay taxes. And what we now have in this European Union is something that manifests itself to be free market, but is actually totally state controlled, completely in the hands and run by big banks and big multinational companies, that is stopping genuine free enterprise and small and medium sized companies from coming up and breaking through. And what we're seeing is low growth. What we're seeing is disastrous indebtedness, and what we're seeing is a very bad deal for those that I think this question was intended for, the weakest in society. We have to make money. We have to make profit. We are now competing against Brazil, India, China, and the whole of the developing world. And what we're doing is we're surrounding ourselves in a cloak that says, oh, we can work for shorter. We have to earn more for every hour that we work. We can retire earlier. It doesn't work. It doesn't pay. Given all the faults that it has, and I admit them, the market is the one that produces profit. Profit equals taxes. Taxes equal a good social welfare system in every free country.
Cosa crede che dovrebbe fare l'Italia per superare la crisi?
So what of Italy? Well, I have been certain from the start that Greece and Portugal were never suited to the euro, should never have joined the euro, and should be set free as soon as is possible. Now for Italy, this is a bigger and more difficult question. You're a big economy, but I think ultimately the real truth is that you're not going to be able to take the Italian economy and the Italian culture and Italian politics and German system and actually meld the two into one and expect a happy resolution. It may not be now, it may be sometime down the road, but I do actually think that Italy does need to leave the euro, does need to get back to the lira, and does need to get rid of Mr. Monti and his cronies. No one's ever voted for them, they've got no legitimacy whatsoever, and the sooner they're booted out, the better.
Ci dica qualcosa dei progetti futuri per il suo partito e per tutto il Regno Unito.
We are very lucky. In the United Kingdom, we fought a very big rearguard action against Britain joining the euro, and thank God we didn't join it. Thank God we're free. Oh, we've got our problems. We've got huge indebtedness, but we have sterling, which is falling on the world markets, which actually is a very good help, given the mess that we're in. My party is not anti-European in any way at all. We want a Europe in which we trade together, cooperate together, we'll even try and be good next door neighbours together. I personally have huge affection for Italy and the Italians, and for 7 years, when I had a real job, when I was in business, I had an agency business based in Milan, so I've spent a lot of time going around Italy, trading with Italian companies. As I said earlier in this interview, you know, we're not better than you, we're not worse than you, we are certainly, though, different to you. Let's have our own forms of government, let's have our own currency, our own languages, our own cultures, we'll come together, we'll trade, we'll be friends and neighbours, and we'll sit down over a good plate of spaghetti and your excellent wine, and we'll be friends. But we should not be forced together in the same political union, and my party will go on campaigning for the United Kingdom to be a free, independent, democratic state, not governed by Herman Van Rompuy, Mr. Barroso, or any of the other ghastly, nondescript bureaucrats that now run the lives of 500 million of us in the time zone of Europe. I'm not awfully good at foreign pronunciation, but I want to say to all of you on the BO Blue, I think that's how you pronounce it, site, hello. I've enjoyed doing this. May see you again.